kind of punchy. Nobody wants to lead.
A lot of descriptors to use when talking about Miguel Cotto, but one thing that always comes to mind for me is the guy's a rock. He is solid.
Yeah, well, the first thing I think about all the time is who the heck is his dietitian? Because I don't know how he makes 140 pounds because he is so big. And he brings it and he goes to that body.
Kermit able to land the counter punch.
Let's see some more head movement.
Kermit Cintron's cheek is ripped open right there. You can see the cut. There it is. Oh, he just ate a big uppercut right there. He had no idea it was coming his way. He does not look good at all. You can start to see. Oh! On the receiving end of a big and accurate hook that wasted no time.
Walked into a room and somebody hit you from behind. You drop. Feel afraid to go in that room again. So, put a light on in that room and explain to him why he got dropped. You will not be afraid to go back in that room.
Kermit Cintron making for a very inviting target right now. You can see the blood around that eye. The cut is obviously worse than it was just moments ago. Good job staying away from the danger there. Cotto's showing you a little defensive skill there. Able to move away from that punch. And now a little combination punching, landing both shots. And coming upon the halfway mark of this 3-minute round. He just missed that shot up top. Lands the left after setting it up with a jab. Needs to improve that accuracy, missed with the headshot.
Well, let's talk about the difference between Miguel Cotto, the version that we saw at 140 pounds, and the version that we saw in recent fights at 147 pounds. Because at 140 pounds, he actually started to have some troubles with his chin, and then seemed a little sturdier at 147.
Yeah, you know, it's funny to say that, because maybe he was killing himself, weakening himself a little bit to make 140. So even though he stepped up, he was feeling a little stronger. And don't forget, the small guy's a little faster. Maybe they were able to find his chin a little more often.
So it's the end of the round, and as both men head back to their respective corners, Teddy, it brings up a good point that many times not talked enough, but the culture of a corner, how guys conduct themselves, what was always your philosophy in organizing and running a corner?
Well, first of all, only one guy could be in charge, that's the trainer. You can't have too many cooks in the kitchen. It has to be organized like anything else. And you have to have calm people. You only have 1 minute. Maybe by the time the fighter gets back, maybe it's 50 seconds. So you have to be efficient. You can't have guys...
Oh, he is not in good shape. He could be on the deck in moments. Kermit Cintron's side is really a mess now due to that cut. You're his opponent. It's got to be the primary target, I
think. You know, and that's the key word, assume. And a lot of people, a lot of fans do assume that you start aiming at that bullseye, so to speak. But I don't believe in that, because now all of a sudden you slow yourself off a little bit. You start pitching punches to that exact spot instead of just fighting your fight, instead of just letting the jab go in the general direction of the head, set up the other punches. You don't want to get carried away or looking to pinpoint that exact spot.
Here.
this guy possesses